Welcome everyone to Intro to Node.js. Thank you so much for coming. I am excited to be presenting this subject to you today and talk about some of the journey I've had from coming from an old school .NET developer from, I was at the Microsoft PDC in 2000 when they announced C#, and I've been using .NET professionally since 2002 when they finally came out with it. I had to wait a couple of years, but I'm Reverent Geek. Reverent Geek on the Twitters, and you could do me a big favor by at least putting a shout out or tweeting something that you found interesting. I try to be funny. I don't know that I succeed very often, but I do try to be funny on the Twitters. And you can trust me because I consume copious amounts of bacon and caffeine. America. I have a beard, and I sometimes know how to computer. So what we're talking about today is Node.js. And as you may have heard Scott Hanselman say before, that JavaScript has won the web. For better or worse, it is the de facto language, the lingua franca, or however you say that. I'm from Georgia, so I don't know how to say them fancy words. It is the assembly language of the web, and everything is just going to JavaScript. We just can't help it. The tide, I mean, what is it? The saying that the avalanche has started and it's too late for the pebbles to vote. So, Atwood's Law. Jeff Atwood said, any application that can be written in JavaScript will eventually be written in JavaScript. And case in point, if you go search for JS Linux, it's an entire Linux VM running in Java in your browser. You can compile C code. It's insane. Literally. And Douglas Crockford, a few years ago, on a panel at DevLink, let's have a moment of silence for DevLink. He said that JavaScript is tragically important. With all the warts and bad parts of JavaScript, it is an extremely important language. And as you may know, Douglas Crockford is the author of JavaScript, The Good Parts, which is suspiciously smaller than pretty much every other JavaScript book on the market. So we know about technical debt, right? We've heard this term used over and over again about the code that we create having technical debt, may having trade-offs and so forth. Well, I was reading recently this idea of innovation debt. Peter Bell says innovation debt is the cost that companies incur when they don't invest in their developers. So a company that's not actively pursuing, the most recent technology and investing in their developers to learn new stuff, doing things like what you guys are doing here this weekend, that you're falling further and further behind, and it takes much, much more effort to even catch up with your competitors or the rest of the industry. So today we're talking about Node.js. Why Node.js? We're going to do a crash course. We'll look at some popular tools and frameworks and look at some integration strategies. And Tennessee wins the interstates. So, unless you've been under a rock, and probably why you're here, is Node.js has just exploded over the last few years in popularity. You hear about it all the time. It's all the rage. All the cool kids are doing it. And, for good reason. It's JavaScript. So I'm an old school JavaScript or web developer. I started doing web development in the late 90s. Been doing it ever since. And, I've fought, my love-hate relationship with JavaScript language. And JavaScript has gotten better and better. And the support for it in the browsers have gotten better and better. Node.js is JavaScript on the server. So being able to take the expertise that you have in writing good JavaScript for client applications, you can now apply that to writing server-side applications, server-side code. Node.js is based on the Chrome V8 engine, so the binaries and the things that you're, it's based on Chromium, and it is, you know, used to be the fastest JavaScript engine. I don't know that it, they're all pretty close right now. It depends on use cases and so forth, but it is very, very efficient, and it's, you know, some people say, well, it's a dynamic, JavaScript's a dynamic language, it's not compiled, it can't be very fast, right? Well, if you think about it, V8, when it executes JavaScript the first time, it does compile it. And .NET, you know, the first time you fire up a .NET website, what does it do? It compiles your IL. IL is not a native language. And so it has to compile it for that particular instance. So V8 on the server is really just as fast as any other type of language. So you're not really hitting a performance issue there. The interesting thing about Node.js is that it's, you know, the JavaScript engine that's in your browsers and it's in Node.js is a single-threaded asynchronous event loop. So that may sound counterintuitive that, well, we're used to dealing with multi-threaded code. You know, if we want to get performance, scalability, we got to spin up more threads. Well, that's not really necessarily the case. An asynchronous event loop, because of, you know, there's a single thread, your code by default is all around an async, in that kind of async and await pattern. And so all your code, you're kind of thrown into the, you know, you fall into the pit of success because you're, from the gate, you're in a pattern of always generating asynchronous code. And with it being asynchronous, this event loop can actually handle far more connections and concurrency and process much more efficiently than a thread per request model, where each thread is taking up, you know, a relatively large amount of memory, and you know, there's a physical limit to the number of threads you can have running, and you got all the context switching and so forth. So actually, a single thread event loop is much more efficient, and they get crazy performance numbers out of Node.js, like a million concurrent connections on a 16 gig box in Amazon. It's pretty phenomenal. The community has also rallied around Node.js because JavaScript is a universal language. Regardless of background, if you're coming from PHP or Java or ASP.NET or, you know, Perl, God help you, or something, any of those things, you know, if you're a web developer, you've had to use JavaScript. And so the Node.js community with you know, it's just the perfect timing of open source and everything that it's exploded. So in the .NET world, we're familiar with NuGet. And NuGet is, last time I checked, somewhere around 30,000 packages. The equivalent in Node is called NPM, the Node Package Manager. And last time I checked, I think it was 140,000 packages. It's like the App Store. There's an app for everything, just about anything you can imagine. Of course, the downside is there's probably five or six apps for what you want to do, and you have to decide which one you want to use, but that's a good problem to have. And interesting, Microsoft is certainly taking notice in how important JavaScript is and how important Node.js as a platform is. So we've known for several years now that with the release of Windows 8 that JavaScript is a first-class citizen in the Windows environment. You can build application with JavaScript and HTML. And that when Node.js first came out, it only ran on Linux. Microsoft is who invested the time and resources into making sure that Node.js could run on a Windows platform. And they generated a lot of tools around it. And now today, Azure, every service in Azure is accessible by Node.js, and Node.js is a first-class citizen in Azure. You can just as easily spin up a Node.js instance and use that in your for your production environment as well as, you know, a .NET app. So my company, our story is we've traditionally been an ASP.NET, MVC, and C#, SQL Server, and then Hibernate, JavaScript, and jQuery. You know, your typical Microsoft stack. And like I said, we're all .NET experts, so to speak, on our core team, and we've been doing .NET for a long time. But this right here, we're a web-based application, and we spend a lot of time building, you know, really rich applications in web, and it's become over time really difficult for us to maintain this large spaghetti code that we've incurred. It's, you know, we've incurred a lot of technical debt, and so we get a lot of this when we're trying to as our application is growing, and there's a lot of this stuff that happens. And we're coming to the conclusion that, man, this .NET is great, and we're very thankful for where we've, you know, what it's enabled us to do so far. But we're having a really hard time scaling and maintaining what we have with thousands and thousands of concurrent users and so forth. It's just becoming more and more difficult. And what we found when we started to experiment with looking at other alternatives is that, first of all, JavaScript, as I mentioned, is a strategically important language for our company. The more we can invest in JavaScript, the better we can be at building our web applications. And we found that from a recruiting standpoint, that, you know, we're no longer limited to a limited pool of .NET developers in our area, which are in high demand. We can also reach out to, you know, basically if you have if you're a good JavaScript front-end developer, we can turn you into a great back-end developer too, leveraging those JavaScript skills, regardless of, and having the, you know, not only that, but there's benefit to being, you know, a polyglot, you know, having influences from other platforms that come in and say, this is the way it's done on this platform, this is the way we solve these kind of problems, and, you know, having those kinds of ideas and so forth come into our company has been great. And we've also found that we have been more productive and just using JavaScript throughout our stack is just less friction. When test-driven development, I have, you know, fought with that idea. You know, we've been told all along that test-driven development is how important it is, and I appreciate how important it is. But what's the typical, you know, curve? You know, you start off and things start to tank, and you like start disabling tests, and finally you just say forget it. We're not maintaining our tests anymore because we got to get the stuff out the door. We can't keep up with the mental friction, the overload of maintaining those tests. But we found that with JavaScript, man, it's so much easier to deal with, to write those tests in the first place, and to maintain those tests going forward. We're moving toward a microservices architecture and using distributed computing things like RabbitMQ, React, and Redis, and being able to take advantage of cross-platform. So Node.js runs on anything. It runs on Windows, Linux, or Mac. And we have people who like to use Macs for development. We have people who like to use Linux, in our DevOps. You know, they are really geek out over Linux. I don't understand, but that's what they do. And there's been a lot more of this instead of the table flipping. It's been a refreshing thing for our team that once we started into Node.js, about a few weeks in, you know, we'd do things like the retrospectives and say, well, how do we feel about this? What do we, you know, how? I know I'd go around to each of my team members and say, what do you think about this Node.js stuff so far? And they're like, I love it. We are having a blast. For me personally, Node.js, and I still do a lot of .NET development. I'm not completely throwing .NET under the bus. At least I'm not trying to. But it has really sparked. I love to learn. That's what it. You know, that's a career developer. you know, ought to have that passion to learn, and Node.js has given me a new fire and new passion to do my job again. So there's a great article out on nearforum.com, why Node.js is becoming the go-to technology in the enterprise. And the highlights from that are rapid innovation and delivery, developer happiness, attracting and retaining talent, and performance. And that resonates with our team, and it resonates with every other organization I've talked to that have been experimenting or using Node.js. And this chart, you may not be able to read the text, but it is from another article called named What is Node.js Used For? And the chart is, how long have you worked with Node.js, and do you like your job? And as you can see, there's a high correlation up here. When people who, the longer people use Node.js, the happier they are with the work they do. I guess that's because of, you know, less friction, again, with the language and with the, you know, context switching between different back ends to front ends. You know, I don't know what all the reasons may be, but this is significant. To me, Node.js exemplifies, start with the simplest solution that works and do one thing and do it well. Node.js itself is, all it is a JavaScript execution engine. It doesn't have a whole lot of capability itself besides, you know, the math libraries and the networking libraries and so forth. It's very, very simple. The power comes in all the modules that are open source and you know, the community and things that you can get to add on to Node.js. And it's very, you know, so you have complete control and power over, you know, your entire application. Instead of being, you know, having things dictated to you in a certain way, you can pick and choose what you want to do. And, you know, as a foundation, it does that one thing of high concurrency and performance and networking and, I/O from a server standpoint really, really well. Commonly heard, you know, in either test studies or case studies, Node.js is blazing fast, concurrent, that low friction I've talked about, cross-platform, and it is the modern, it's built to be the modern web server. There are a number of great case studies available. Fandango is a .NET, traditionally .NET shop, as we are, and there's an article on Near Forum, Fandango goes live with Node.js, and this comes from the CTO, that they experienced dramatically shorter development cycles, and they're also moving to a microservices architecture and being able to easily deploy and manage their infrastructure. PayPal ran an experiment where they had one team, they're a Java shop, or used to be a Java shop, and they had one team build a new application or a new set of features using Java, and a different team build the same exact thing in Node.js. And what they found was 2 times faster development with fewer people, a lot less code, a lot less files, and 2 times improvement on request per second, and 35% decrease in average response time. I think what's interesting about these results is they've been doing Java for a long, long time. So these guys are supposed to be the Java experts, and yet a team that had just picked up Node.js and run with it, they were able to come out with further ahead than their Java team. Walmart ran an experiment on Black Friday. Go figure. They launched their brand new mobile platform on Node.js on Black Friday in 2013. They experienced over 200 million concurrent users consistently throughout the day. They never broke 1% CPU utilization, and they even tested deploying updates in production during the middle of the day on Black Friday, and they had no problems at all. I have a good friend that works at Walmart. Walmart is actually a strong contributor to the Node.js community. They have a Happy and number of other open source projects that are really awesome. Who else is using Node? Lots of big companies. If you go to node.js.org/industry, you can find a much, much bigger list. Node.js use cases. Single page apps, of course, and API servers. The ubiquitous Hello World app for Node.js, if you look at any like getting started intro article or a pick up a book on Node.js, it's going to be a chat server, like a real-time, you stand up multiple instances of the client and they instantly connect and you can do real-time communications between those nodes in just like a few lines of code. It's just like ridiculously easy to do, and that's what it was built for real-time communications. It's amazing. Proxy service, we'll talk more about that in a little while when we talk about integration strategies. But pretty much also known as the internet. If you do anything that touches the internet or build any kind of web apps, Node.js is pretty solid. DevOps, so hot right now. DevOps loves Node.js because of the small footprint and being cross-platform. The event-driven nature and of Node.js makes it really easy to publish messages and publish, you know, metrics and do all the kind of health checks and kind of things. We have our own web application framework that we've created on top of Express, which is a popular MVC style framework, and we have like metrics and health checks and all that stuff built in, and our DevOps guys love that. And there's lots and lots because of the community. Like I said before, the timing of this is just like the perfect storm, right? So you got all this contributions to open source. Node.js has come along right at the right time, and the DevOps stuff that you hear so much about, there is a lot of resources being poured into building tools and services for Node.js in this DevOps space. Installing Node.js is really, really simple. Go to Node.js.org, pick the green, big green install button, and run it. Now, who has heard of Chocolaty and you're running on Windows? Good. I'm glad to see more and more hands every time I give this talk. But this is worth the price of admission right here. If you're on a Windows platform, install Chocolaty, and it gives you the ability to as like a apt-get or package manager for Windows, you can easily install applications straight out of Chocolaty with one line. It takes one line of code to install Chocolaty, and then from then on you can use one line to install other things. So this is like the first thing I do when I stand up a new VM, either on my Mac or in Azure or wherever, when I want the tools that I want. I just install Chocolaty and I have my script of things that I like to have on that that platform for development. As I mentioned before, Node.js is just an execution engine. When you install it, bells and whistles, this is all you get. You get two command line utilities, one called Node and one for NPM, which is your package manager. That's it. So to run a JavaScript application with Node, it is simply Node space something.js, and that's how you run it. NPM makes it really easy to install things like, I don't know, web developers, you're familiar, like Lodash and Underscore and those kinds of utilities. You can install those and use them in Node. NPM install Lodash, and you've got it in your project ready to go. On Windows, there are a couple of other dependencies you should be aware of. Not every NPM or Node module that's out there is just pure JavaScript. Some modules contain an amount of C code that has to be compiled on your current platform. And that's where it can harness libraries that have been, you know, cross-platform C libraries, you know, throughout the community, some old things, to be able to do things like image processing or video encoding, some things that are CPU intensive that really do need to take advantage of the full, you know, power of the hardware. So the two things you need on Windows is Python 2, which again with Chocolaty, it's real easy. Choco install Python 2, and you will need Visual Studio Express, Visual C++ 2010 Express. And you can get around with this particular version, but by default, if you need to compile C code on a Windows machine, the build targets that are in those modules are looking for this particular, for 2010. There's ways, like I said, there's ways of getting around it, but it's just easier just to go ahead and install this Express edition. So if you run into, you know, adding packages to your Node.js app and it blows up trying to compile, that's probably the reason. You're missing one of those two things. How many here are .NET developers or use Visual Studio? Alrighty. So, in case you weren't aware, there is a Node.js Tools for Visual Studio. You can download that off of nodejstools.codeplex.com, one of the last few things left on Codeplex. But Microsoft has open sourced it and put it on GitHub as well. The minimum requirements are you need 2012 Pro or VS Community 2013 or the new VS Community 2015. You'll need the latest Visual Studio updates if you're running 2012 or 2013. And if you are comfortable with Visual Studio but don't want to install these tools on your machine, and you have an MSDN subscription, you can go and create a, there's Azure VMs that you can fire up that have Visual Studio and the Node.js tools already installed and ready to go. There's also, if you don't want to use Visual Studio, you can use just a straight text editor. I can show you things like Atom or Sublime Text is very popular with Node.js developers. WebStorm is a great product from JetBrains. You know, everybody's probably familiar with ReSharper. WebStorm is pretty awesome. But Microsoft just recently launched this Visual Studio Code, which is a text editor. Interesting thing is, it runs on Linux, Mac, and Windows. Are they using Xamarin? Nope. It's Node.js. So Microsoft built this editor using, they patterned it after Atom's or GitHub's Atom editor, and this is running the same desktop shell that Atom uses. And it's got built-in support for .NET. You can compile .NET code, and you can debug and run Node.js code as well. It's not a full-blown IDE. It's kind of code assistance. It gives you some like things like IntelliSense and gives you debugging capabilities. It's pretty cool, and I'll show you that. How about some cheesy demos? Any questions so far before I dive into some demos? Yeah, I'm spending way too much time talking.
What about Node.js is easier for testing than .NET?
The expressiveness of the language. So when you get all kinds of syntax, because JavaScript is dynamic, you get all kinds of syntactic sugar where you can, the modules that you use. So I recommend, and I'll show you when we look at tools and frameworks, but tools like Mocha and Sign-On and Chai make it really easy to express tests and to do things like mocking and proxying and those kind of things that are, you know, when you're dealing with types in .NET, it's really hard to set up those mocks, to set up all those tests, to maintain like two different versions of types, one for the real world and one for the mocking and one, you know, those kinds of, you know, all those kinds of things that cause a lot of friction in, you know, when you're dealing with static languages, you just don't have to deal with in JavaScript. It just makes it a whole lot easier. Does that answer your question? Yeah. All right, so I have, this is my Windows 10 VM running Enterprise 2015. What was I thinking? Nothing. What could go wrong, right? I just set this up right before I came here. So if it fails, I'm going to blame Microsoft, not me. So I'm going to start a new project in Visual Studio. And when you install the Node.js tools, it gives you a new Node.js project templates under JavaScript. And so you've got all these things you can choose from. There's blank Node.js console applications. There's several different web applications. And there's several different Azure templates as well. We're going to choose a basic Node.js Express 4 application. Express, as I mentioned before, is probably, arguably, the most popular MVC-style web framework for, I guess you could call it a framework. It's like it's a place to get started to building a good web application in Node.js. So I'll choose that, and we'll call it Code on the Beach Express. All right, so this first thing that pops up is saying the newly created project has dependencies, and do you want to go ahead and install those dependencies? And I'm going to say yes, hoping that the Wi-Fi cooperates. So I'm going to close this for now and look at the project structure that this creates. So NPM, as I mentioned before, is very similar to NuGet. And what's going on behind the scenes is it's going and downloading these packages from NPM, and it's done. So this operates just like very similar to NuGet. There's a bin folder, but this is like a startup file. It just tells the application how to start. It's not an executable. It's just a script file. And then there's public, which contains your static assets like images and JavaScript style sheets. Routes are modules that act as both your routing and your kind of like your controllers. So if you've seen something like NancyFX, it's similar in that we'll look at one of these in a moment, but you express the route and as well as the body of that definition in the same place. And then views are like your templates for, you know, coming from ASP.MVC, you know, Razor templates or web form templates. We have an app.js file and a package.json. Package.json is like a manifest. It tells your Node.js application some metadata about the app as well as a list of the dependencies. So the Visual Studio knew what modules it needed to download and install because those were listed in this package.json file. So let's take a look at app.js. This is the main entry point for an Express application. And this gives us some things to talk about. So Express itself is very lightweight and unopinionated, and you basically set up an Express app with the modules that you care about, the things that you need in your application. You know, it's by default, Express hardly does anything for you except serve up some static files. But even then, you have to tell it where those static files are located. The thing that's important, though, is like these require statements up at the top. There, you'll see that there's two kinds, one with just text like Express and one with a relative path. So these that are up here that are expressed as just a name, those are modules that you pull in from NPM. So Express is like the NPM install Express, and path and those things are all either modules that you've brought in using NPM, or they're modules that are available to Node.js internally. These, the routes and the users, those are pointing to files inside your application. So this is how you reference your own modules. When you create those modules as a JavaScript file, you reference them like this. So you can think of these require statements as both like a using or an imports statement from .NET. It's kind of the equivalent, but also at the same time, it's creating an instance of that object, an instance of that class, so to speak. It's a So you have direct, you know, you have immediate access to the properties and functions that are available on this Express object. So the rest of the stuff is just like composing and setting up the application itself, like setting where the views live and what view engine we're using. I'm not crazy about Jade. Is anybody here ever used Jade or know what that is? Just a few of you. Yeah. So I'm not crazy about it because I come from Razor, and I actually have grown to like handlebars, but as you can see, it's real easy to swap out one view engine for another if you want to use something besides Jade, which comes out by default with the Visual Studio deal. Let's just go ahead and run this. This will fire up the debugger and then our browser. And Express, welcome to Express. Woohoo, right? This is awesome. Web app. We're webbing. Yeah, it's real exciting. Microsoft really knocked themselves out coming up with this template. I wonder why. They couldn't go just a little bit further. All right, so that's all well and good, but let's take a look at our default route, our index for the home page, and you'll see that we have our require statement pulling in or referencing Express, and we're creating a router, and this is router.get. So get is our method, our verb for HTTP. So you can express router.get, router.put, router.post, those kinds of things. You can respond to different verb types. And the second parameter is a path. The first parameter is a path. The second parameter, this is the typical callback pattern that you'll see throughout Node.js code. So this is a callback function. This is how you do, one of the ways you can do the asynchronous event loop. When you want to, most code in Node.js, you're going to call this function and say, when you're done with the request that I've made to you, I want you to call me back using this function. So this is an inline function. We could have declared that function somewhere else in the statement. We're just doing it inline here. But this is really important because this is what allows Node.js to do its, event loop processing. So it can handle concurrency on many, many requests because it can do these things asynchronously. So we're saying, here's a ticket, go do this work, and then when you're done, call this function and pass me back a request and a response. So these two parameters that are expected back are the request and response object. And then we can do special things like set headers, set cookies, do whatever we would do with a web response, and then render that. And we're saying render the first parameter is like the name of the template we want to render, and the second parameter is our object model. And so since JavaScript is a dynamic language, we don't have to have a type. We can just declare willy-nilly whatever objects we want to pass back. All well and good. The last thing I want to point out is this module.exports. This is the secret sauce. This is the magic statement that you need in every one of your modules to say, this is what I expose to the rest of the world. So you can do all kinds of crazy code inside a JavaScript file, but whatever, none of that is visible unless you set an object to module.exports. So just keep that in mind. That's the way that you, it's kind of like your public interface. So I could declare some other object and set that to exports, and that's when somebody does a require on my module, that's what they will see. So Visual Studio gives us the ability, shockingly, to do things like set breakpoints. And I can set a breakpoint there, run this again, and I have hit my breakpoint, and I can mouse over and see things like the internals of that response object, all the properties and functions. I can look at the other objects that have been declared. I think response. You've got a locals and a you can set watch points. You've also got a call stack. So all the things, you know, standard kind of debugging experience that you would expect from a .NET application, you get the same kind of thing with a Node.js application as well.
Does an intermediate window work too?
Yes, it does. So you can. Well, it doesn't print out as much stuff like you might hope. Let's see, has body. Yeah, so you can do some evaluations and stuff using the immediate window too. So you can play around with the code, you can debug it just like you would hope to be able to. Another thing that comes with the Node.js tools is a interactive window. So this is a great way to start exploring Node.js and the application language. And it's kind of like the old school REPL from VB days, showing my age. You can do things like x equals 3, y equals 2, x plus y, and you can play around with objects and do all kinds of stuff in this interactive window. It works really well. So I'm going to change this to code on the beach, and I'm going to go over to the template, and this is Jade, avert your eyes. It's strange. It's, you know, your H1 P's is block is white space significant. It's strange. Thank you for attending my session. And now let's run this again. Get past the breakpoint. Woohoo! This is an awesome web app, right? Doing all kinds of stuff. Man, look at that guy go. Best demo in the world. All right, so let's look at, you guys are familiar with NuGet, I assume. So npm, you know what? When I click this, it's probably going to say, I've got to download a bunch of packages. No? Awesome. So it's already done. So this is like your NuGet manager. I can search for things like Lodash, and I can see the modules that are available. I can click on that, and I can click install package. So if I click install package here, it's executing this command, npm install Lodash dash dash save. And when that's done, I can see that Lodash is now in my list of dependencies in under npm. And if I open up package.json, it's also listed here as well with the semantic version that it pulled down. So this is really important when you go to deploy your Node.js code that you know your dependencies list everything that you have. So you can run npm install on that machine to pull down the latest dependencies and go from there. I'm going to switch over to Visual Studio Code. This is running, it looks identical on Windows and Mac and Linux. This is running on my Mac, and I can do the exact same things. I've got all my code over here. I can set breakpoints, and I can, under debug, I can launch this application. It's firing up good stuff. And I can go over to, I got to launch a browser. So I'm going to hit 3,000, which has probably hit my breakpoint, I hope. No? What's going on? It's Microsoft's fault. It's probably because I installed something here recently. May have. Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's 3,000. Because in here, it's defining as either my environment variable port or 3,000, and I don't have an environment. I don't have an environment variable set on this, but it should have launched my browser anyway, my default browser. Let me just try it one more time. Yeah, I think it's because I installed a new version of the Node debug tools and may not be compatible with Visual Studio Code. Not sure what it was working earlier. Well, the thing I want to point out, though, you do have all your debugging capabilities, and you can look at your variables and watch statements and call stack and your breakpoints. And the other interesting thing is it integrates with your repository. So if I change a file in Visual Studio Code, I can get a nice side-by-side comparison of those changes. Check those. It's got Git integration, so I can check those things into Git. It's a pretty decent editor, and nice environment to work in. I personally use Sublime Text, and a number of modules in Sublime. Right. Cheesy demos. So deploying a Node.js application. When you do run npm install, it puts everything in this special folder called node modules. You typically don't deploy that with your application. Because you may be building it on one system architecture and deploying it to another, like if you're building on Mac and you want to deploy to Linux, you're not going to want to deploy that node modules folder because it may be different on a Linux machine. So you're going to deploy the app and run npm install on that target machine so that it can pull down the modules and compile them if necessary for that target. Now, unless you know for sure what your build targets are, you could have like a continuous integration server that's running the same server architecture as what your production servers have, and you could do that build step on that CI server and then package everything up, and including the node modules folder. Azure is super duper easy. Who was in Nick Molnar's talk earlier on Azure? So you can do the exact same thing with Node.js as you can with Azure. You can create a new website, choose Node.js as a template. You can connect it to a GitHub repository, so as soon as you push changes to GitHub, or not just GitHub, any repository really, it integrates with Visual Studio Online and Bitbucket and Dropbox for who knows why. If you're deploying to Windows, there's a couple of things you want to look at. IIS Node is a module for IIS. IIS Node is a module for IIS that allows you to basically have a mini web farm, so it can take advantage of however many cores that you have on that machine. It can spin up a node process for each of those cores and do all that fancy stuff. Windsor, if you're just deploying like a service that's maybe like a microservice type deal, where you have a service that's listening for messages on a message bus or exposes particular ports for HTTP communications, Windsor will allow you to install that as a Windows service so that you can, looks like any other Windows service on that machine. You can start and stop it. You can pause it, all those kind of things. And if you're deploying to Linux, you'll want to use something like Forever that will launch that Node.js. Because remember, Node is just a execution, it's just a command line utility. So you need a way to launch it and make sure that it stays running. So Forever is a good option that we use on Linux, and there's several others. As I said, hosting Node on Azure is really, really easy. Go to your portal, click New, choose from the gallery, an empty Node.js site, and you can connect to a repository. As I said, this is, if you go to my blog, reverentgeek.com, this is exactly what I have running for my blog. I've got Ghost, which is a Node.js blogging platform, and if I push a change to my Git repository, typically within less than 60 seconds, that change is live on my site. It's pretty awesome. And I also have an article out on my site, Hosting Node.js on Microsoft Azure, and I go through both the simple and the more complicated steps that if you want to run your own VM, you want to run services, you want to use IIS Node, you want to debug IIS Node, you want to stand up services using Windsor, I cover all those things. And I'll provide a link at the end where you can go and find all these resources I talk about. Recommended toolbox. Lodash is a great set of just basic JavaScript utilities. Win is a promise library. It's an alternative to callbacks. A lot of people complain about, well, with Node.js, yeah, you're doing async, but your callbacks can turn into callback hell because they get nested and nested and nested callbacks. Well, you can overcome some of that using promises. Promises are a really awesome way to compose. Even if you're doing client side frame, you know, JavaScript, you can use promises and really manage your JavaScript code a lot easier. Async is like, you could think of that as a task parallel library for Node. It allows you to execute, you know, say I want you to run these 10 jobs, and when they're all done, let me know, kind of thing. So you can run in parallel or run serially. There's a lot of options there. Request is an HTTP client that's really good for like calling into other web services, either internally or externally. Gulp, we didn't talk about test runners and stuff, but Gulp is one of many. It's like a flame war over who's got the best runner. But we use Gulp, and I think it's pretty awesome. So it can do your build steps and run your tests and do all those kinds of things that, you know, as part of your strategy for building apps. Socket.io for real-time stuff. Node Inspector, if you're gonna just use a text editor for building your Node.js apps, Node Inspector is your best friend. What it gives you is the ability to type, instead of typing node space and then server.js or whatever your file is, you can type node-debug server.js, and that will launch your Chrome browser with the Chrome debugging tools poised to start stepping through your application. And then you get all the, you know, the Chrome debugging experience that you would expect with doing client-side, you can do with server-side code as well. It's really great, and that's what I use. Mocha and Chai and Sign-On, those are the testing stuff I talked about. Chai being it's kind of more behavior-driven testing setup than a test-driven. So you can be really expressive about, you know, coming up with specifications for your apps instead of just unit tests. And the Sign-On with the spies and the stubs and the mocks, you can do some really powerful things with, you know, being able to intercept calls and being able to know how many times, you know, a call was made, or, you know, being able to assert lots of interesting things. Popular Node frameworks. On the MVC side, Express is definitely the most popular, but there's other great ones like Meteor and Sails and Happy. These are more like opinionated in that they give you a lot of tools out of the box. Like if you want a great API, Happy from Walmart, man, they've got, you know, really solid starting point for building an API stack, and as well as, you know, a full-blown web application. If you're doing just API, Restify and Loopback. Loopback is interesting in that it gives you push notifications, like if you're building mobile client type stuff, you can do push notifications right out of the box. And then my company is working on this auto host and Hyped. We're focused on doing hypermedia, HAL or HateOS or however you say that stuff. And if you go to nodeframework.com or node web modules, there's like a ranked list of all the popular, most popular stuff you can get for Node. Edge.js allows you to run .NET in process. So if you want to take advantage of your existing .NET code along with Node.js, you might be interested in this. It allows you to run not only C# code, but any .NET language, including PowerShell. You can execute inline scripts or reference CS files or even reference assemblies. And it's an alternative to writing native modules in C. So if you got really, really kung fu ninja skills with .NET and you want to be able to leverage some stuff you've written in .NET over in the Node.js world, you can do it. It does require .NET 4.5 or Mono 3.1, and that's because of the async and await support. You don't want your .NET code blocking the only thread that's available to you on nodes. You need to be able to play nicely with Node, and your code needs to be use that async and await pattern. So even if you have legacy code that doesn't use async and await, you can wrap that in, an assembly that calls those functions using the task parallel library, using async and await, so that those things are spun up on their own threads and play, the callbacks play nicely with Node.js. So with Edge.js, you can leverage your .NET investment. You can do things like SQL Server. Of course, SQL Server now on Node is first class. There's the support for it has come a long way, but not so much the other Microsoft stuff. So, the Node.js community loves everybody except maybe Microsoft, not so much. But there are modules available for some of these things, but they're usually half-baked and abandoned because they were, somebody built them for a specific use case, and it doesn't support the whole, what you may want. So you can use Edge to call into that those good libraries. Like we use it to call into using for TFS integration from our Node services. You can also do things like hardware and video encoding or other CPU intensive work. And PowerShell, for like DevOps kind of things. You could do some really interesting things from your Node applications on your machines.
How about WPF?
WPF? Yeah. Like for a desktop?
Not for
Silverlight
style.
Yeah.
Yeah,
there is console apps. Yeah, in theory, you could launch a WPF app from Node. I'm trying.
But would you have integration with it?
Yeah. So Edge.js gives you the ability to go both ways. So if you have a .NET application and there's something in Node.js that's really awesome that's not available in .NET, you can use Edge.js to call into some Node modules from .NET as well. So you can leverage both ways.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So integration strategies we've talked about. So Node.js is a proxy. This is a kind of the strangulation pattern. This is what a lot of companies have started doing as they migrate from whatever their platform is to Node.js. This was Walmart strategy and PayPal strategy. So you build an API that includes all the functionality. And then that API acts as a proxy. So when a call comes in, it needs to determine, is this something I can handle, natively in Node.js, or do I need to hand this off to some back-end service in running .NET or Java or whatever? And Node.js being so efficient with networking and I/O, it's an excellent choice as a proxy in this way. You could use Edge.js for .NET. You could use the request module for calling other APIs. So again, kind of like the proxy pattern of composing lots of different services together and exposing those through Node. And messaging, RabbitMQ or Azure Service Bus, everything outside of Microsoft is first class, and Microsoft has made sure that all their Azure services, like Azure Service Bus, have really good clients for Node.js. I also wanted to mention Electron. Electron is the desktop cross-platform application shell that GitHub has built for Atom and is also driving a lot, a good number of applications these days. If you search for Electron Node.js, you'll land on GitHub's page for this. Visual Studio Code runs on Electron. Slack, which is an awesome chat instant messaging platform, we use it all the time. It's built on Electron, so it's a Node.js application. And Atom itself, this is what they created it for. And I've been playing around with this, and I think it's really cool. It's allowing me to develop desktop apps that I can then ship to my customers that doesn't matter if they're Linux or Mac or Windows. And I went down the path of building some desktop apps in Xamarin. Xamarin's great for mobile applications, even though it does have some, there's some frustrations there, but the mobile side of Xamarin gets a lot more love than the desktop side. So even though you can build desktop apps with Xamarin, I found that it's way, way easier building on Node.js with this Electron platform. Last thing I want to leave you is you don't need permission to be awesome. I know, I'm sorry going over a couple of minutes, but this is my personal philosophy and something we care strongly about at my company. The things that you're learning today, I hope you learned some stuff from me in this talk, but take what you're learning this weekend. Your employers will thank you in the long term, at least, and if they don't, then they're not the right employers to be working for. But go and take some of this stuff and run some experiments. And before I let you go, the guy who is going to be speaking about ASP.NET in the next session had to cancel, and so I'm going to be giving another talk on Kanban. I don't know if you're familiar with Kanban, but it's a way of managing work. Basically sticky notes on a whiteboard, except way more than that. If you liked my hand-drawn illustrations in some of my slides, my next talk is 99% hand-drawn illustrations. So it's a lot of fun. I love giving that talk, so I encourage you to stick around. This is my contact information. You can get lots and lots of stuff at this link, including the demos and books and videos and stuff to get you started with Node.js. Thank you very much.